So in today's session, you will be getting to know how to build a basic to-do app using React. And in the end, we'll share some more details with you regarding the program. So I think Zeeshan can start now.
So, hey, hi everyone. So Zeeshan this side, a React.js professional. So basically our today's session is all about React.js fundamentals. So in this session, we are going to cover what is React.js and what are its fundamentals and why we are preferring using React.js in real-time production applications. So like in today's industry, every companies like Zomato, Swiggy, and Uber, they all are using React.js for their web applications. So React.js is very powerful for front-end. It provides us very dynamic nature to build dynamic component and composable and reusable component. So it's great. So let's start the session right now. So overview of our session is what is React.js and what is JSX and what is the component in React.js and what are its benefit to use component in React.js and how JSX is how JSX differ from HTML and just give me a second.
Hello, Zeeshan, are you there?
Yeah. So let's start the session. So I'm just telling about the overview of the session. So what is React.js and what is JSX and what is component in React.js and what are its benefits? So how JSX is differ from the HTML. So whether how browser understand the JSX, as we all know, browser only understand the JavaScript. So how JSX is differ from the JavaScript and what are the state in React.js and what are its use and what are the proper props and what are its use. And there are some lifecycle method in React. So what are the what is the component lifecycle and what are the lifecycle methods and how we can use them efficiently. So at the last, we are going to create a mini to-do application to understand the concept of the React.js and its properties. So let's start from what is React. So basically React is a JavaScript library, which is created by the Facebook and maintained by the Facebook. So basically it is not a complete framework. It is just a library. Anyone can use it and plug in with any other library as well. And React.js is available in open source, so anyone can install it and use it. And React.js is a user interface library. So basically we all hear about like other technology as well, Angular, Vue, and something like that. So some of them are fully MVC. So MVC, something like that, model view controller thing. So they provide all the things like that. You can connect with the database, you can write the API controllers, and you can create view in as well. So whether in React.js, React.js is provide us only with the view layer of the application. So basically we can say React.js is a building tool for the UI components. And we can create the dynamic website and single page application, PWA application, progressive web applications, using the React.js. Okay, and it only handles the view layer of the web and mobile applications. Okay, so let's understand the most core fundamentals of the React in which it's standing. So basically React.js use some fundamentals. So like that, there is a concept of virtual DOM. So basically DOM is something like that, how the elements are represent in the browser. So how elements are representing the browser. So in React.js, there is a concept like virtual DOM. So it not consider like that manipulating the elements in real DOM are expensive. So it degraded the performance. So in React.js, we have a concept of virtual DOM. So whenever there is an update in the component, React.js first update the virtual DOM, then compare the virtual DOM with the real DOM. If there is a difference between the virtual DOM and real DOM, then render it to the real DOM. Okay. So React.js also supports the server-side rendering. So server-side rendering obviously increase the performance of our application. So in terms of it render the page first, and whatever the API calls at the backend side, it will make the data available, and whenever the data available, fully render the page to the browser. Okay. So in React.js, we have a unidirectional binding. So unidirectional binding is something like that. So we have bind data from one side. So that is from UI side. Okay. So there are two kind of binding in front-end engineering, something like that. One-way binding and two-way binding. So in two-way binding, used by many other technologies, something like AngularJS and Angular 2. So in that, you can bind data from controller and model as well. So in React.js, you can bind the data from the view layer only. So there is a unidirectional binding, and data will be flow unidirectionally. And React.js allow us to create the reusable, composable components. So in that reusable, something like that, whenever you need a single HTML component, something like that, if you need some button element in 3 or 4 or component, and in that you need different stylings or something like that, so you can easily compose the button element or the singles as a single element, and you can use it anywhere. So it provides us to reuse the code and dynamically configure the component and nesting the component as well. So in that, we can create our own component and nesting them with another component as well. So what is JSX? So JSX is something like that extended version of the JavaScript. So in that, we can say Java. Basically, JSX stands for the JavaScript XML, and it is a combination of the JavaScript and HTML. So like HTML, JSX tags have also name, attribute, properties, and children as well. And we can create our own custom tags or element in the JSX as well. So basically, it provides us syntactic sugar to create an element in the React. So we can say as React.js follow all the properties of the ES6 in ECMAScript 6, if they have concept of classes, they have concept of calling constructor function, and there are so many spread operator, let operator, something like that. There are so many things in ES6. So basically, React.js follow the ES6 concept.
Zeeshan, someone has asked you a question.
So basically, it is server side rendering. Okay, so in server side rendering is something like that. We are not render the page at the client side. So basically, there is a proxy server in between the client side and the backend server. So whenever there is a request come to the proxy server of the client, so it first fetch the HTML from the client and render it to the browser. So it creates the skeleton of the page before getting any data from API. So sometimes what happens, there are some backend APIs in which we need to fetch the data for client side. So there is a server call. So it may take around 2 seconds, 3 seconds. So sometimes it degraded the user experience at the application. So it will take around 3 seconds, 4 seconds to load the first page or home page of the application. So in this, what happened, server side rendering first render the page to the user profile. So whenever the data comes, it will feed the data into the application, to the page. So it will fully completely render to the browser. Okay, got it. So let's move ahead. So basically we have also like JSX is a combination of the HTML and JavaScript. So we all know like that browser only understand the JSX, JavaScript. So how it can understand the JSX? So for that purpose, we have so many, we have a tool called Babel. So that is called transpiler for the JavaScript, JSX. So in for JSX, first we transpile our code into the JavaScript, and whatever the JavaScript, we then feed that JavaScript to the browser to make browser understand what we want to create, display on our web page. Okay, so one more thing like that, ki what how JSX works. So first, whatever the code we write in our React application, it is completely JSX, combination of the HTML and combination of the HTML, JavaScript and inline CSS as well. So what happened, whenever we use the class component in React, so there is a render function in which we write all the JSX. So what happened, whenever we create the render function, it internally called the React create element function. So in which it create the HTML component for that class component. So whenever we compile our code to display it over the browser, so there is an in-between tool that is called Babel. It transpile our JS6 code into the ES5 code, that is ECMAScript 5, which is understand by the browser. So transpile our code into the ES5, which is understandable by the browser. Then browser render our page and create the element and component inside the DOM. So which make our user to see the fully web page. So what is inside the component and what is about. So basically what is React component? So React component are the basic building block for the UI in React. So it let us to split our UI into independent reusable pieces of code and think about each piece of code into isolation. So let our one component is independent of the other component, and that is highly composable. We can use that at a number of other places. Like if you want to use that at 10 places, 100 places, it doesn't matter. You can use any number of places that. So conceptually, what is component? Component is a JavaScript function which accepts some inputs as a props and return a React element. What we want to appear in the screen. So basically, there are two types of components. Basically, there are two types of components in React.js. One is functional component and second is class-based component. So functional component are, we can sometimes call geo component as well. So basically there are two types of components, class component and functional component. We prefer use the class component whenever we need some state inside the component. So state is something like that. A local object that is belong to that component on. So a state can only be muted by that component and can be used by that component on. We can only pass the state of that component as a props to the other component. Okay, so another feature of the class components are, there is a constructor function which is used for calling the properties from the inherited class. So there is a concept of the inheritance in that. So basically our each and every component in React is inherited from the React.component class. So in that it has some default properties. So which property, something like that, there is a this object, there is a context of this. And there is a lifecycle method as well in class component. So lifecycle method is something like that. In React, every component has some lifecycle. So it has to be initialized, it is to be mounted into the DOM, it mounted into the DOM, it gets updated at some time and it will unmounting from the DOM as well. Okay, so in class component, we get the lifecycle method as well. Besides the functional component are something like that. If we don't need any state and lifecycle of the component, then we prefer to use the functional component, which are so basically it takes the property as an argument and in which properties we can use for inside our component to make it dynamically and composable and reusable. So we can provide any attribute properties and styling as the properties as well, and we can pass any number of props inside to the functional component and class component as well. So basically, what is state versus prop? So what is the states and what are the props inside the React.js? So whenever you heard about the React.js, there is always a question. So what is the state of the, what is the state and props inside the React.js? So basically, state of a component is an object that holds some information that may change over the lifetime of the component. So basically, that is local to that component. So props are the input to the component. They are single value or object containing a set of value that are passed to the component on creation using a naming convention similar to the HTML tag attribute. So basically, whenever we require any component, composable or reusable component inside React, so we can pass any number of attribute or properties to the component, which we can further use inside that component to make our decision whether what we need to display and what we don't need to display inside the component. Okay, so state can only be mutated by the set state function. So basically, the state that is local object to a component can only be mutated by the that component, and we can mutate state only this dot set state method. So this dot set state method is available with us inside a class component with its default properties. So we can use that to mutate the state of the component. So there is some time question. So why state is an object? Why can we directly mutate it? So if we directly mutate it, it is not going to re-render inside or it is not going to re-render our page or component. So basically, whenever we update a state using the this dot set state, it re-render our component again. And state only be mutated by the component to which it belongs. So what is props? So the primary purpose of props in React is to provide some component functionality to the component. So basically, we can pass custom data to our component. We can trigger that state changes, and we can use the props, this dot props dot react prop. So basically, whenever we want to use that properties that are available inside the this object of the property inside our render method. So we can usually use that, make our decision whether what we want to display, what we don't want to display, how can we make our component more dynamic, more reusable, more composable. So these are the things. So props cannot be mutated by the child component. So basically, whatever the inputs we get from our parent component inside the child component, we cannot mutate it. So we can mutate the props inside the child component. So there is a need. If we can't mutate the properties inside the child component, so how we can mutate it if there is some need to mutate the props from the child component? So there are some tricks or workaround. So if you want to, there is some need, if you want to update the properties from a child component, you can easily register a callback from a parent component and pass that callback as a properties to the children component, and then call that properties callback function from children component to mutate the property of the parent component. So we can use update the that way as well. So basically, what are this the component lifecycle? So there are so many. So as we all know, in React.js, every component has its life cycle. So there are three phases, basically three or four phases inside the component life cycle. So there is one mounting, one is updating, one is unmounting. So basically mounting is something like that. So basically mounting is something like that. If we want, whenever our component mount into the DOM of the browser. So there are some lifecycle method which we are going to use. So from that, there is a constructor method we are going to call whenever the component mount to the browser DOM. There is a render method, there is a component did mount method. So what is the use of the constructor, render, and component did mount? So basically, whenever we pass any props to the class component, so in constructor method, we call the super method of the inheritance or constructor, from which we can carry all the properties which are passed to the class component. Then we can initialize the state object inside the constructor method, and we can bind the other event handler or other function to inside the constructor method to the this object of that component. So basically, whenever we are using the class concept, so there is always a in JavaScript there is a functional closure. So every function have its their own closure. So if we want to bind the any function to the context of that class component, we always need to bind it manually. Otherwise, we have to use arrow functions. Arrow function is the extend feature of the ESX, which allow us to write function neat and clean. And in arrow function, they did not create their own closure context. So they are automatically bind to the class context. And render method is something like that. In render method, whatever the JSX we need to render into our component in browser, we have to write inside the JSX, and whatever the decision we need to make, which part of the component we need to display, and conditional rendering, we can make conditional rendering as well inside the render method. And component did mount is also another lifecycle method, in which it is the method which called when after the page render into the DOM. So whenever if there is something like that, we need some data from some server, it will take some time. So this type of functionality we need to go and work inside the component did mount. So whenever the component mount into the DOM, it initially is showing the skeleton of the component, and whenever the data fetches from the server, it displays the data to the DOM element, to the browser. And another phase of the component lifecycle is updating. So updating is something like that. Whenever we making update, we think like that we want some real-time changes. We don't want to trigger something manually. So in component, say class component, there is a set state method, so which help us to make changes to the current state of that component. So whenever we call the this dot set state, it allow us to re-render our page again. So in this method, so we can say in update, whenever set state call, it re-render our page, and whenever our page re-rendering, there is two lifecycle method we can say: should component update, render, and component did mount. So should component update is something like that, whether we really need to update the component and re-render it again. So it is something like that. If our state have some attribute like count, its previous value is 5, and whenever we call and we again set state and set the value of count 5, it obviously call the re-rendering the page. And what we have to use should update, in which we can check is previous value is differ from next value. If value is obviously differ, then we only need to update the component and re-render it. Otherwise, we don't need to re-render it. It degraded our performance as well. And render method is something like that. Whenever page re-render, render method will again call. Component-driven update is something like that. It always take the previous state and previous properties of our component and check whether there is some delays in UI or we need to some fetch element from DOM or something like that. So if we want to use some third party UI in our component, so this lifecycle method help us. So another phase of the component lifecycle is unmounting. Unmounting is something like that. Whenever we unmounting or removing the component from the DOM, browser DOM. So there is one lifecycle method which is called whenever when unmount the page, unmount the component. So the lifecycle method which called is component will unmount. So component will unmount is something like that. If whenever our component unmount from the browser DOM, so if we want to reset some values or is there is some work which we want to reset whenever the component removed from the DOM, so there is something like that. So thank you guys, this is all about the React.js fundamental. So you guys, if you guys have any query, so please ask. If you guys have any query, you can write to me. So I will explain it again and you can.
Guys, like Zeeshan said, he's done with the PPT part. So I think Zeeshan will be moving to the app building part, right?
Yeah.
Great. So I think no one has any query. So I think you can proceed.
Okay, fine. Give me one. Okay, so guys, let's start with the to-do part, practical part of the React.js, in which we are going to create a simple to-do application which will allow us to add a new to-do into the our list and remove a to-do our list, and in which we are just making a strike to the our to-do which we have done already. So if you have any query regarding that, you can ask. So okay. So basically React.js provides us a one inbuilt tool that is called create react type, so which allow us to give all the scaffolding or skeleton of the React.js application. So that name create react type, so basically I have already installed with the create react app, so which I can check this with which create react app. So it will showing me my create react app package inside the user local bin and create react app. So if we want to initialize or create the scaffold of our to do application, so we have to start with like create. Create React app, and what we can name it. React to do. Okay, fine. So we start the create React app, React to do it.
Zeeshan, I guess you've got a couple of queries if you can just have a look.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, okay. No, not a problem. I think they're asking about this recording. Yes, guys, we'll be putting it on our YouTube playlist soon. And you can just check it out in a week's time. Okay. Yeah, Zeeshan, now you can start.
Okay, cool. So create React app provides us all the scaffolding for our React application. So I just initiate an application create with create React app with name React2D. Okay, so let's change the directory to the React to do. So okay, so now we I'm going to open this inside the my Visual Studio Code. Okay, open folder. So React to. Okay, so okay, fine. So this is the scaffolding which is provided to us by Create React app. So inside this we have a folder of node modules, and inside that there is a public folder in which we have all the assets, and there is the index.html. So and after that there is a source folder which contains all the our source code which we are going to write, and there is a .gitignore file. So whatever the file and folder we want to ignore to commit to the Git, we can use, we can add them into .gitignore. So basically there is a package.json file, so which contains all the dependencies and scripts which we are using inside this application. And at the last, there is a readme.md, which is a markdown file, which help us to read all the instruction, how to run the application and something like that. So move to the terminal. So let's move to the terminal. Here my React to do. So let's start our React to do using npm start. So basically npm start is the script which is written already inside the package.json. So there is our start script which takes React script start. So internally let's start the application. So internally what happens, so our all the code is in ES6 classes. There is a Babel transpiler which takes our all of the file and transpile them into ES5, which is understandable by the browser. So and we also create the bundle which using the Backpack. So Backpack, basically internally Backpack is used to bundling all of our application into a single file, so our browser can understand which what we have to render or what we have to serve. So Backpack also provides us the functionality of the hot reload. In hot reload, what happens where whatever the changes we make in real time is going to be updated at real time, and we can see in our browser inside the changes. Okay. So initially, whatever the scaffold provided to us by Create React is something like that. It is by default running on localhost 3000 and provides us the simple page which contains the logo of the React.js and a message, added source app.js and save to reload. So which clearly told us if you want to make it composable or dynamic, you have to added the app.js. So let's go to the our editor. So app.js file is inside the source. So basically this is our functional component, okay, so which we are going to use and which we are going to edit to create our components like to do application. Okay, so let's start. So basically before going to start, we have to understand something like that. So whatever the bundle we are created by using the Backpack is inside the public file inside the build. So basically our Backpack server serve the index.html file, this take the element root, and inside the our source there is a index.js file which render our app component and get element by id by root. So basically it's what doing, take our app component and display, render it inside the div of the id root inside our index.html file. So cool, let's start to edit the app.js file. So like that, what I'm going to do, I'm going to use the class based component. So okay, let's create our class component, app component using the class. So basically class extends. So, and that, as we said, in class there is a constructor method. So after that, define the constructor method, which take props as the argument, whatever the props we pass inside to them. So that is our constructor method. So initially we are not going to define inside the constructor method. So basically at the last, whatever that we want to render inside our browser, we have render method inside the class component. So let's define render that method. That returns if we want to like that initially how our page should update. So we, and as of now I just want to add and head it heading, that is h1 heading. Say hello, but just save the file. Let's check the browser. Okay, so as of now there is no use of constructor. I just remove it and getting like that my page getting update to the browser with hello world. Okay, so let's move to create the component. So basically first of all we have to decide what kind of architecture we are going to do. So basically for as of now what I'm thinking, so initially to do I am keeping 3 or 4 to by default to do which are undone initially. So let's create a file, data file for to-do data. So which has a, inside the source folder, I have to create a new file named with to-do data. Okay, so basically from this file, I create an array of object that is a to-do data, which I am going to return and use as our default to-do app. So there is a const to-do items equals to, this is going to be an array and array of object. So in object I have following properties. So one is going to be index. So like index is defining in which index we want to re-render. That is going to be 1. So what is the second, we can say value. You can name it any property. So value is something like that, name of the to-do. So we can write key, I have to take t. And third property we want to like that initially we mark all the to-do as done true, like that key some of the to-do are done and something some of them are not done. So true, making done as true is something like that key we have already completed this to-do. So something like that we can going to same structure for other to-do as well. So like copy paste. So basically going to index with 2, 3, 4 and randomly make them some of them true and some of them false like that. pause. So, and another like that value of the first todo is take t, and we can say second take path. Then we can say we need to shopping. Then we can say have to go office or whatever you want. Okay. So after creating the array of todo items, we need to use it inside our app.js file. So how we are going to use this inside our app.js file? So we need to export it. So for export, we have to export default a name of the todo items. Okay, so we can export default. So basically there are two kinds of export in React, in normal JavaScript or after ES6. So there is one is named export, one second is default export. So we can import the default export with their name, and for named export we have to use our curly braces before to import it. So basically, okay, we can change on todo something common to the file name, so we can easily import it. Okay, so this is our todo data which we are going to use inside our app.js file. So now inside our app.js file, we are not going to use that logo, so we have to import. So now we are going to import the data inside the app.js file. So we can name it todo data from file. So it's the path of the file. So file is inside the same folder. So ./ represent it is inside the same folder, and todo data is the name of the file we want to import. Okay, so this is our import from the import of data. Okay, so another is how we are going to compose our todo application. So basically going to compose it into four components. So one is the header part. So header part is showing something like that todo list. Second is the todo list which we want to display what are the our todos which are done and which are undone. So, and third is the form. In there is kind of todo form which help us to add new todo inside into our list. Okay, so this kind of architecture we are going to use, and inside todo list we are going to another composable component, that is todo item. So in todo item, so basically our todo item is something highly composable in which we are going to take all the action, how we mark the component todo done, how to mark todo undone or something like that. So okay, let's create another component, that is todo header. So okay, have to create new file name with todo header. So okay, for creating a component we initially need to import React from React. Second, inside this, if we are going to use any CSS, so basically in that I'm going to use a app.css file, so then import app.css. okay, cool. So now I have to define my component. So basically my component is going to todo header. So this is going kind of like that
Zeeshan, I hope you you've checked the chats. There are a couple of.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, sorry. Sorry, guys. Thanks for the update. And there is another query like that, ki what is difference between states and props? So basically, state is something like that, a object that is only belong to that component. If we want to make our component composable and dynamic, so if there are some checks, say a part of the component I want to display only if this properties or something like that true or something like that. So state holding the information only about that component. We are not going to use that state information into another component, and we can only update that state into the component only which it's belong. So if we want our component is totally controlled, and like that, basically what happened if we used HTML, we clearly directly define value equals to, if there is an input always have a value if we directly define value equals to something. So in that kind of component, the component is uncontrolled and there is no control over the React to the component, and we are not making handle it dynamically. So if we want handle the value of that component like that, this dot state or some attribute properties, so then it is controllable all by the component, and we can change and take action into the state object by any of the lifecycle method or any other props method or whatever. And props is something like that, whatever the attributes we are passing from the parent component to the child component. So basically React components are highly composable. We can create our own component as well. So if we want to pass some properties of the parent component to the React component, children component, so how we can? So there is a something like that in HTML component, there are so many attributes like ID, name, style or something like that. So like that, we can pass any number of properties to the our own composable component as well. And there is one difference like that, ki we always prefer to initiate our dynamic component with the capital letter, as our all the HTML tags are in small case, like div, span, h1 or something, as so on. So to create a difference between our composable and our own component from HTML tags, so we always prefer to initialize our component name with the capital letter. So that's why I'm using to do header T with capital. So that makes difference with HTML tag as well, something like that. So okay, in header I just want to display an heading that is named to-do list, because we are going to create a to-do list application. So okay, cool. So okay, how we are going to use that component inside our app.js file? So okay, let's move to the app.js file and import to-do header from to-do header. Okay, so we make the import of the to-do header component. So I just want to like use that to-do header inside our app.js file component. Okay, so previously we are using the only h1 html tag to display hello world. So now I have to remove that. So basically in render method, we can only return a single component from the return. And if there is a multi-line JSX, we have to use the round bracket to return that JSX. So previously we are using the single line HTML or JSX, so we can easily use the inline. So if there is a multi-line or something else, so we always have to use round bracket and write that multi-line JSX inside that application. Okay, so we want to use todo header inside that. So basically we can use like, we can use this way as well, and we want to write in single tag as well. So this is inline closer. So just save and go to the browser. Okay, sorry, I forget to export it. So just go there. And then see, yeah, we got the to-do list here. So React.js also provide us the full stack of the error. So where, what we forget, what is the error actually, and what we are missing or something like that. Okay, so we can easily use that as well. So after that, we have to create, want to display the to-do list as well. So let's create a to-do list. So now create a new file, name with todo list.js. Okay, so for creating a class based element, first I need to import React from, and after that I have to create a class named with todo list extend react dot component class. Okay, so basically we want to render something from as of now, then we will compose it. So what we want to render, so we want to create a render method. That going to return a multi-line JSX. So as of now, we are rendering just for understanding as to that name. We can name it something like that. Okay. First to do. So how can we use it inside app.js file? Just go to app.js file, import to do list. And I just want to use it right now like that. Just want to say, okay, so it's showing me some error before we, so as I told you earlier, we can return only a single element. So here we are using two, this one is different one JSX element and this one is different, so we need to wrap it inside the single element. So for that we can use the div container of the HTML to wrap all of them inside the single container. Okay, so that's cool. Error's gone. Okay, let's move to the browser. Okay, so it again showing me does not contain a default export into the to-do list. Okay, so it clearly mentioned I forgot to export that component. So let's come export export default to-do list. Okay, the error is gone. So this is something like my first to-do. Okay, so now our point is like that, how to display multiple to-do. So for that, like that, we are restructuring our application, something like that. So we can easily understand the how we can compose the component into smallest part, smallest component, and how can we reuse it. So like we can not rewrite the code again and again. So what happened in HTML, if we want to display a list of component, I have to return HTML again and again or something like that. So this is not in the case of to-do list. Okay, so let's create a new file named to-do items. Okay, to-do list item, whatever name you want to give. So like to-do list item.js. Okay, so in to-do list item.js, basically this is going to be the most fundamental like that key part of our application, in which we are managing the each and every single to-do. Okay, so let's to create a class component, first we need to import React from React. Okay, so let's create a default like class component name with to-do list item. Okay, so class to-do list item extends React.component. So in this we have to render method that is going to return something like that. So we, for as of now, we are going to return H3. So we can name it anything like that, some T time, something like that. Okay, so how we are going to use this to-do item inside the to-do list? Okay, so let's go to the to-do list. We can import list item from to-do list item, and let's check. Yeah, I again forgot to export it. So export default okay. So let's okay, cool. So I already get the to-do list item. Okay, so how we are going to like that, what we I can say, okay, so if I want to render this like the okay, what as of now I just create a dummy const number of list of item like that key, I just create for the dummy purpose, items equals to 4. So this is something for like that, I just want to what I can say, rendered multi using the list of the rendering the list of the component. So I just want to display 4 time list item into 4 time. Okay, so there is a items array that is called 4. So I have another like that how many items I am going to render. So I can say that there are, it is an array of four elements. So I just want to display to-do list item four times. Okay, so I can just map, loop through it and create, render our to-do list item. Okay, so we can say const display items. Okay, so display item is a function, like that we are mapping through the loop. So here is our loop is items, so we can loop through items dot map. Map is a function which apply a particular function over the array. So let's say it take its iterate through our array, which takes a callback function which takes two argument. One is item, second is index, and we have to use arrow function. So in this, from this arrow function, we are going to return something that is JSX, which we are going to display inside the to-do list. So from there, we are going to return multi-line JSX, whatever we want to return. So from this, we are going to return the to-do list item. Okay. So to-do list item is our item. So this is our to-do list item. We are just re-render it four times, and inside the return function of the to-do list where we are displaying H2, now we are going to render an order list. Okay, so inside an order list, inside the return function of the class component, we can use the JavaScript inside the curly braces. So these curly braces indicate that inside the HTML, I am using the JavaScript object. So basically display items is in our JavaScript object, which we want to re-render it. So we have a couple of queries right here. So what do you mean by composable? So composable is something like that. You can use three or four or any number of component or dynamic component to compose your own component, something like that. If you want to create your own dynamic component which contains three buttons or some number of inputs or some custom styling, so that you are composing it in according to you. So the means of composable, something like that, you can create it, compose it according to you, according to your needs, something like that. So another question is, state of one component is available in another component. So state of one component is available into another component only through the props. We can use the state of like that. It is just like a properties or variable. So you can just use it inside another component, but you can't mutate or change it through the another component, something like that. So there is another question. So why we are using default every time? Is it the way to use, or is there any significance of that? So basically export default or export something like that. Export default is indicating that I am going to import it using the default name or something. And named export is some like that. We have to use some standard way, like there is a named export function to import it inside any other file. I have to use a curly braces extension. So through which JavaScript can understand whether you want to importing a particular function or you are whether you exporting a particular function, and inside an another file I am importing that particular function, and in that I am exporting defaults like my class is exporting default, and by its default name it is available.
Guys, I think if I'm not wrong, Zeeshan will be starting with the Q&A in the next 10-15 minutes, right?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So guys, when I took the poll, a few of you showed interest in the program. If you want, you all can just ping your email IDs to us so that our team can contact you. And yeah, we can continue it. Yeah, Zeeshan, you can
continue. Okay, yeah. Fine. So, okay, to do this thing. Okay, so it's throwing some error. To-do list item does not contain export default, but it is already included there. Okay, no worry. What is that? I will check it. So as of now, like that, I want to return something here from here. Hello to do. Along with that, index of to do plus one. Okay, so it is showing me something like that. There is I easily displaying to do list. So it contain hello to do one, hello to do two, hello to do three. Okay. Okay, guys, let's move to. Okay, so now we have to configure our to-do list item. So let's go to our to-do list. So along with that, we also need to create a form that is something like that for submitting, creating a new to-do. Okay. So let's create a new file. Inside the source folder. So that is new file. To do form.js. Okay, so in that first I have to import from React, and after that I have to create a class that is to do form extends. React.component and okay, my bad. Okay, so okay, in to do form we have to we are going to create a form. So line it's a render method. We are going to return multiline JSX. So it can we are going to create a form. So basically start a form. In that form we have a one input box and one another button. So import that is type of text. second, we are going to create the reference. Like reference equals to name. Item name. And okay, create a add a placeholder. After that, we have a button. That is type of submit. The name of the button is add. Okay, that's cool. And at the last, we are going to export it. Okay, so inside our app.js file, I'm going to import it. That is to do form. And we can just after a line break, I want to display my to-do form. That's it. And let's say there is a form, add a new to-do and with button. Okay, so let's add more functionality to it. So we have to do more work into the app.js file. So okay, so like we have a function, so whenever we want to add a new item to the to-do list, what we have to do. So for that, we have a function name add item. Okay, so so this function takes the to-do item which we want to add inside our to-do list. Okay, and so like that we have a to-do data that we are going to use. So in to-do data, like unshift, and in to-do data we have properties index is to-do data dot length plus one. So that is something like that. Key, as we need previously defined key, first to do with one index, second and third. So whatever the length at that current time, we decide assign the index with that. And value of the to do is always whatever the item we pass to do item and whatever the new item value is inside that. So inside that we are going to pass new value, that is new item value. And after that it is done or not. So initially whenever new to do add, it is not done. So we keep done as false. So this is something like that, adding the item. So our item is adding successfully to the to-do list. So how to run our UI get know ki our to-do get added to the list. So for that we have to update the state. So for that we have to call this dot set state function, and is this function takes an object, and in that object we are going to update the state property. So in state property, for state property we have to first create the state property. So like that we have to create constructor function that takes props as argument and curly braces. Then we have to call the super function with props, and then we have to declare this dot state equals to an object in which we are going to define first our to do item. So it takes to do items. So initially to do items are something like that, to do data, whatever the data we create initially. So we assign to do data to it. So we define the states here. Okay. So, and here we are going to update to do items property of this state with the updated data, that is to do data. So unshift, what happened? Unshift. So, okay, fine. So basically we update the state. And this is throwing some error. So like that, this is an add item function. This is not bind to the this context of this object. So for that, we have to do this dot, whatever the function name, equals to this dot function name dot bind that take an argument as this. So basically this is our add item function. So for like that, we have, whenever we want to mark done or undone and any to do, so how we are going to do that. So for that we have another function, mark to do done. That takes the item index as parameter. So in that we fetch the to do according to the item index. So where to do equals to do data, that is the same as this. So we can just copy paste, and to do data, just passing the item index inside it to fetch the data. And after that to do data, we are going to splice the to do data with item index, with one. And after that, whatever the to do is, we will reverse it. What is the value of the to do done, like that to do done equals to the not of the to do. So it will, either it is true, so make it false. If false, make it true. It is something like that logic. And we are using some CSS part here. So to do done. So we are going to like that to do data dot push to do. Otherwise, to do data dot unshift. So basically, it is a ternary expression. So in which, if a to do dot done condition get true, it execute the data after question mark. If false, then after colon. So it is to do unshift. So which unshift the to do, and after that we have to update the states, which is same like this. Okay, so after that, these all methods are going to be used inside the to do list and to do form. So for, we are going to pass two properties to the to-do list. One is items, that's value going to be equals to the to-do data. So this is going to be the list, and we just copy paste to-do data. Another property is mark to done. So mark to done. This is this dot. And for initially we have to bind this as well with the this context. So this is bind. So to add a item, we always add item from the form. So add props, add item. Add item. Okay, so that's cool. That is okay. Yeah, cool. Okay, so now move to the our form part. So first we finish the form part to add the item to the list. Then going to the other part as well.
Hey Zeeshan, think we've only 10 minutes left, so I think we can start the Q&A in a few minutes
okay, no issue. So I will share the GitHub link with
them. You can take 5 more minutes to complete this, and then we can start the Q&A.
Okay, so after that, in to-do constructor, we have a props. We call the super with props. So for that, we have also create the submit method to submit the form. So for that, we create reference. That is form and on submit properties. That is going to this dot. On submit, and for we have to define on submit as well, which takes event as the argument that is named E. So first of all, we have to prevent default behavior, stop the default behavior of the form submit. Then we have to check, we have to create a new event item value. That is always equals to the this dot refs. So refs are basically for fetching the element from the DOM of the browser. So in React, there is no other way to fetch the element from the browser. So basically we are using the references. Okay. Then we are checking if new item value exists. Then we are going to call this. Then we are going to add method of this dot props dot add item, which we had passed as the properties to the form, which is some like that here as a properties add item which available to the form. In that we have passed the new item value. So then after that, whenever we pass, so and whatever the value is available to the form, we reset the form. We fetch the form this dot refs dot form. Ref is same as the we pass the ref property to here. So this dot refs dot form dot reset. So we reset the form, and we also need to bind this with the this context. So here we are this dot on submit equals to this dot on submit dot bind, which take this as argument, bind successfully here. So as we can see, so if you want to add new item, okay, is there something missing inside the add button? Okay, sorry. So I have to call one lifecycle method. This is which is component. Did mount, and component did mount is always focusing on the item name, this dot refs dot item name. This is the same reference as here dot focus. Okay, let's check that. Okay, because of we are not making change to the to-do list now. We are not update making any update here, so it is not going to re-render. But basically it's add to the, so we can check here. So we are not using, it's okay. So this is basically debugging console. So we can debug anything, whatever the wrong from here in applications, inspect element. If I want to inspect it, what is the to-do list value? So actually basically what happened, I am not get updating anything inside the to-do list. So let's go to inside the to-do list. So as there is a issue with the timeline, so we already reached the 8:30. So we have to start Q&A or we want to finish this?
Yeah, how much time will it take, Zeeshan?
No, it will take time. Actually, we also make update to that to-do list item as well.
Okay, okay. So you'll be sharing the GitHub repo with us.
I will share.
Yeah, yeah. Can you show the output or right away or like you?
Yeah, I can show the output if you want.
Yeah, yeah. You can just show them the output, like whatever you've done, how it'll look in the app, and then I think we won't have time for the Q&A. We can end the session. A few questions can definitely be answered. Okay.
Yeah, yeah, sure. So basically, output is something looks like starting my backpack server, something like that. So initially, I mark two of them as done true and two of them as done false. So if I'm going to add new to do, go to office, something like that. So it will add to the list at the top. So and if I want to mark any of the to do done, like shopping is done, it will mark this one is red and move that to the end of the list. So to do is something like that. So our application output will be something like that. So I will share the repo around 1 hour. So you will get the.
Yeah, yeah. We won't share it immediately, but yeah, we'll be sharing them when we put your video on our YouTube playlist. So there we'll give the GitHub link as well. Thank you guys. If you have any queries, Zeeshan can answer some few quick questions. So please ping your query to him and we'll definitely share the session recording and the GitHub repo, the code files and everything on YouTube playlist in a couple of days. Okay. So yeah, we are waiting for your questions. Any questions, guys? I've shared the feedback form with you for this session. Please fill it. It's very important. because we need to know your thoughts on the session. And regarding the program, we'll be launching it on 16 December. You can visit our website, greyatom.com. So like I said, the program, you know, the USP of the program is you don't have to pay anything upfront. Take the program, take the training, and once you get a job, you then pay us. So that's the USP of the program. And whoever is interested can visit our website, can ping us your email ID. So our team can back to you, get back to you. And I hope you enjoyed the session. So I think there are no questions, Zeeshan. Thanks for this wonderful session. And we'll be sharing the stuff with the students. Okay.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you, guys. I think we are good to end the meeting now. And thanks for the session. Have a great evening.
Log on to GreyAtom's learning platform to unlock more free content. Subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon for regular updates.